Welcome to a new test and teardown video. Today we're going to play with this CTR model SWG-26. I think it's also from Conrad Electronics in Germany. It's from 1967. Oh, so it's very, very old. And I mean, look. I only polished it a little bit and just wiped it nice and clean. You can't really see that this is from 1967. It's about 2.8 kilos, so it's a little bit heavy for its size. It is, of course, a tube, sine wave, square wave generator. You can see here we got sine wave and square wave, and you select the output waveform here, and this is of course the four frequency ranges. So times one is of course 20 hertz, and then 1000 times 200 is 200 kilohertz. So that is the frequency range. This is also explained in the specifications. I found both the manual specifications and schematic on radiomuseum, so definitely go there and have a look. I better open it first and do a little inspection before I power it up. It was of course completely full of dust, so I went outside and brushed it nice and clean. And this is the super simple design. Of course, they made a really easy to access main entry fuse. And what we got up here is the one silicium diode there is. So this is for the high voltage, and that will be high voltage filter capacitors. This one is the 1287, also known as ECC80. One, this is a dual triode, and this one is only used to amplify, like double mega amplify the sine wave into a square wave. So in sine wave mode, you don't need that one. That tube is the 6BM8, and I've been double checking the writing on it. Oh, we can't possibly see that, can we? So yes, 6BM8, right? This is also known as ECL82, and this is a triode, a pentode, two in one. It's quite easy to see, one is very small and one is very big. So yeah, we got those two tubes in one, and the that's what's doing the sine wave oscillation. And there is one more important part down there. Let's see if we can get a tiny little picture of that little glass part down there. It is a little filament bulb. It is of course driven at very, very low current, so it's not lighting up visually. I don't know if I'm super happy about its location very close to the hot oscillator tube. It could have been placed somewhere else, so it's only compensating for the level and not the temperature of the tube. I don't know if that is really a problem or not. And here is of course the power on indicator running on 6.3 volt, the filament supply. Look at that, it's a little bit flimsy, the design. All the other components there here on the bottom side. Yes, of course, the circuit board is a patinax type. Single layer, of course, to keep costs down. And yeah, when I was playing a little bit with it, I felt the output level knob here was loosey-loosey, and that is because there is a flexible coupling And that is just super duper loose. Can you see that? I don't know if I can fix this easily, because this is so annoying when there is that much slack. Got a little bit of extra modifications, loose components hanging. Oh yeah, there's one thing that bothers me a little bit with this design, by the way. And that is the main transformer is only with two wires sticking out of it like that, not four. So that means there's no way you can change the mains voltage level. So this is for Europe voltage only. So you're not going to find this unit in the States. That's just how it is, because this is 230 volts only. And the wire is with a chassis ground or protective earth wire. How about that? So I should probably change the connector on the wire, so it's also using a proper 3-pin, because I really, really like chassis to be grounded for my own protection. But I feel this is quite safe to power up, so let's do that. So I am now ready for powering up the first time. Mains is applied and no current. Oh, we got a lamp. You can even see the reflection. So what have we got done here? Ooh, this is the output potentiometer. And then we get a lot of DC output when I crank the potentiometer. So that immediately tells me to turn this off. Oh, and it is in square wave. So there is a shorted capacitor. Wouldn't you say that? If we look at the schematic and the amplitude will give you DC output. I mean, that means we have a capacitor problem, or maybe I'm just loading the output way too little. I should probably try and take 1/10 of the output. That means we will have some loading resistance. And let's see if that, see, this does not affect my problem. So I get DC output. And then of course the oscillator is running, and then it goes, okay, it goes down to 0 volts. Well, I think there's a capacitor that's, maybe it's because the oscillator here can do 20 Hertz. So that means this transfer capacitor is just very, very, very big. Oh, this is a nice clean sine wave, but I do see a little bit of, can you see that? It's modulated with a little bit of hum. So that's probably also affecting my, yeah, you can see that we got AM modulation, but I mean, we got a single wave rectifier. And what we could do is measure the harmonics, or the total harmonic distortion, using my THD measurement equipment. That could be a good idea. According to specifications, it should be maximum 3%. So let's see if it is that. Maybe I misjudged this sine wave and the voltage amplitude modulation. I mean, it looks like it is a lot, but I just picked up my distortion meter here. Let's see if I can get everything here on the picture. I go to calibration. Ooh, this needs to be 100%, and then you go back to 10%, so it's 0.8. I think there's a filter in this unit that removes 50 Hertz modulation, or 50 Hertz noise, like what you see here on that screen. I mean, it gotta be that. But I think I wanna go and check out the capacitors in the high voltage supply, and maybe they're completely broken, or maybe this is just how it is with only one diode. So let's try and measure the anode supply. And I believe it is these two. First we go in DC mode. Maybe I can do 130 volts of DC. And you see they actually put two capacitors in parallel here. 20 micro on each of them. And then we go into AC mode. And then we got almost 2.1 AC. And what else have we got here? What have we got on this one? So that's a filter. That's probably a resistor or some stuff here. Maybe it's that one. So then it goes down to 123. And the AC is now a lot less. 0.3. Okay. I'm gonna go and play with these capacitors and look a little bit on the schematic. Maybe I can figure out on the schematic what is going on. Because this is our diode for the high voltage rectifier. So here's how it looks like. The two red wires, that'll be the high voltage. And that one goes here. So remember, this is where we got the diode. And then it goes to the capacitors. And then from this point we have a resistor that goes to this point. And then we have we've got two capacitors, if I'm not mistaken, right? Yeah, that will be the diode. And then will be the resistor and more capacitors. As you see here. So those two are probably in parallel. That is not exactly what I see, is it? Well. And they added one more here on the back. So this is definitely a problem. I just got an idea. Let's see if I can fix this. So I've been playing a little bit around and measuring those capacitors. And they're not really that bad, especially not for their age. 1967 or something like that, right? And we got 5-6 ohms of internal series resistance in this. And if I take a brand new modern one, same value, yeah, maybe it's about half if I find the best ones I got. The problem is not really the series internal resistance, it's just value. Because there's also another thing called XC. And you want those to be able to filter at 50 hertz. Remember, there was only one diode. That little crappy diode here was the high voltage diode. So my idea is you can either make the capacitors like higher value, or you can also double the frequency. So by using a bridge and by having both of these two wires directly to the bridge and then to the capacitors, I will, of course, get a tiny little bit higher voltage, but I will just increase the series resistor here. The first one is 300 ohms. That one I will just increase until I have the wanted voltage on the output side. And that will just filter a little bit better. But what I want you to see here is, if I can get this in focus, that point down there. This is where they... Why can't I get this in focus? Do you like this distance here? This is 120 volts. There's zero distance to ground. That is just bad. Look at that. That is so idiot. That is something I need to fix. Oh man, I need glasses here. Yes, so I'm finding some really nasty ones here. I don't know what you think about this. I didn't touch anything, did I? Remember? It was completely unstable in the amplitude. And of course, when we looked at the schematic, you can see there is no power supply rejection ratio in this design. And this is a classic tube design. So you need to double, triple filter and all that kind of stuff with your anode supply. So here's what I did. I got now a bridge rectifier in here. I go to a 100 microfarad capacitor in parallel with one of the original ones. And then my 300 ohms to the next one. Of course, I needed to change that to 1K, so I will have the same anode supply here, about 122 volts. Higher resistor here, and of course a new capacitor here that is better. Now my anode supply is that stable. So how much did this change the distortion? Not a lot. Let's try and look. Is it still in calibration here? Like that, right? So less than 0.5%. It's not a lot less, but I think this meter is not responding to the 50 hertz amplitude we saw. If it would have been that, the difference would have been a lot more. So I think that is a that is a, some sort of a fault in this meter, really. It's not responding to that. So that's quite funny. So now the meter really works, and I'm super happy about that. What else can we do? So the only thing left is to see if the readout is accurate. So this one is as accurate as I can put it, and my frequency meter over here says 988. So let's try and crank it up. Oh, then it says 9.61. Should have been 10 kilohertz, right? And this should be 100 kilohertz. And it is 107. Ah, so there's a capacitor here in this range. I just need to modify a little bit so I can fix this. How nice. And then the maximum frequency should be 200. And it is 208. Okay, I can of course go a little bit higher, but I'm only interested in the readout here is accurate. So that was definitely what I wanted to see. That should be 100 hertz, right? Aha, now you can see a tiny little bit of ripple, but that is also very difficult to do with a tube oscillator. That is 20 hertz, it should be, but it's 17. And I got the same amplitude all the way around. Wow, yeah, I don't want to drag this video any longer. I am very, very happy about it so far. So all I want to say is thank you very much for watching, and I hope to see you very soon again. Bye-bye.